Hallelujah. For those of you just joining in on us, we've been going over the first general epistle of John, and now I believe we're in chapter 4, and we're going over the Reformation aspects to absolutely uproot the stronghold of the sinning Christian mentality, which destroys any visage or any vision that we can live victorious as Christians, that we can live victoriously over sin, that we can walk in love, and that we can walk in compassion, living lives of integrity and living lives in power. All right, I'm starting to really run out of time. I don't know if I'll have to run over more than 12 videos. It might be more than that, but let's see what we can do for the sake of time. We're in the fourth chapter of the general epistle of John, and it says, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus is Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now is already into the world. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them." You need to understand that there is a worldly church that parallels the true church. Let me make this clear. There is a worldly church that poses as the church, that isn't the church. But they, because they're worldly, they will always speak of the world, and the world will always take their side. Any church that tells you you can live in sin and still be saved is a worldly church. But any church that tells you by the grace of God, by his loving mercy and his blood, that you can live victoriously over sin is the true church of God, preaching and speaking and most of all, living the truth. Okay. All right. Verse 4. "We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." And you see now that God is two things consistently. He's holy and he's love. Okay, and I remember I talked about that in some videos before. Those are the two major pillars of God's character and ministry and the Christian life. "He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And this was manifested, the love of God towards us, because God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwelleth in him, and he in us, because of the Spirit he's given us. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect or mature, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this present world. I just got to stop there, because I am moving through it quickly, but I got to stop there. See, when we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. If we're walking in the light, we are just like Jesus. And being like Jesus is what kills the sinning Christian. Because if you're a sinning Christian, you're not like Jesus. Because Jesus wasn't a sinner. And guess what? Neither are you if you're born again. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. I quote that a lot, but sooner or later, we're going to get to it. We're going to get to the whole Pauline writing that gets into that. And I'm telling you, we're coming. It's going to destroy the sinning Christian. I mean, right now, we're uprooting this thing that you can live in sin or walk in hate or not walk in love. This whole chapter is almost like a love chapter. Let's repeat this again. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this present world. And you're going to have boldness because you spent the rest of your life after you received Christ walking in his light and in his love. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect or mature in love. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. So if you're hating your brother or sister, but you call yourself a Christian, you're nothing but a liar. This is going back to the first chapter. If I say that I love God, or I'm walking in the light, but I walk in darkness, I lie and do not the truth. Okay, so if I say I have no sin, not loving my brother, I'm a liar and his word is not in me. Keep it in context how the apostle thinks. Okay. If a man say, I love God and hate his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And this is the commandment we have from him, that he who loves God loves his brother also. So, as we're moving toward the end of the epistle, and we're getting into the great chapter 5, I just want to say to you, can't you see that as we go through these epistles, and I've already read 1 Peter and 2 Peter to you, and some parts of Romans. Romans is a big read. I'm not going to do all of Romans yet, but I want you to know as I go through the smaller epistles how dynamic the apostles preached and the presentation of a victorious Christian life. But you can't have a victorious Christian life if you still have your sin. If you're still living in sin, then you're saying that Jesus is saving you in your sin, and he's going to take you to heaven with your sin still attached. Now I'm telling you right now, sin ain't going there. You need to leave your sin with Jesus. Give it to him, because he already destroyed it on the cross. He already threw it out of the way. He's not going to save you in your sin. He's going to save you out of your sin. You had the sin, he takes it away, throws it into the sea of forgetfulness. You're set free from sin. He gives you the gift of righteousness, a new heart and a new spirit. If you have a new heart and a new spirit, well, if you're born again, how can you be a sinner at the same time? This is the Reformation teaching that I'm giving to you to destroy the sinning Christian stronghold that blocks revival. And if you add eternal security to it, okay, which I don't totally disagree with eternal security, on the different grounds, but if you add it in the sinning Christian light, then it becomes disastrous, because now not only are you a sinning Christian, but you're saved eternally in that sin, and it don't even matter if you commit sin, because you can't lose your salvation. So Satan's got you stuck, and you're enjoying the trip, enjoying your sin, just enjoying sinning up. Oh, I think I'll do this sin, and I think I'll do this sin, and when I'm done sinning, I'm going to go to heaven when it's all over. Now, let me tell you something. If you believe that, you're deceived. If you believe that lie, you're deceived. You're going to bust hell wide open. You need to fear God and repent. Listen to this word. Listen to what I'm saying. I'm not clotheslining preacher. I'm just saying, if you're living in habitual sin, breaking God's heart, breaking his commandments, hating the brethren, walking in strife, walking in vices, you're not saved. Or if you have been saved, you've certainly walked away. And I'm not going to vaccinate you again. I'm not going to give you some shot. I'm not going to give you a shot to vaccinate you against the gospel so you won't ever respond to God. I'm going to give you a shot of the truth so that you can respond to God in deep repentance. If you don't like what I'm saying, that's okay. But at least for God's sake, examine what I'm saying in these epistles and cry out to God and say, Lord, if what this man is saying is true, show me, Lord, open my eyes, give me a clearer understanding. Look, it's time to get right. It's time to get real with Jesus. We are not sinning Christians if we're Christians at all. You can't be a Christian and be a sinner at the same time. You have to be one or the other. You got to find out which master you're serving. You're serving the old master? Or you're serving Jesus? Which one? Because if you're serving Jesus, you're the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ, and you don't have sin anymore because he took it. If you still have your sin, maybe you need to repent. Maybe you need to be born again. Or maybe you need to turn back to God because you've gotten away from Him. Whatever it is, it ain't equaling you sinning and going to heaven. The soul that sinneth will surely die. Now the works of the flesh, which are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, idolatry, lying, all that list. Those that do these things, as I've told you before, as I've told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. I have to be bold. I had to share the Reformation message so you could repent. All right. We're going to get into chapter 5 and close it out. But anyway, hang on. We're not done yet. We still want to deal with these issues in Reformation so that you can be able to turn from your sin and say, Lord God, give me a new start. All right. I'll see you in a little bit. Bye-bye.